सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत्। ॐ शान्तिः शान्तिः शान्तिः। शन्नो मित्रः शं वरुणः शन्नो भवत्वर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः। नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु मामवतु वक्तारम्। ॐ शान्तिः शान्तिः शान्तिः। So before we start today's discussion, let me just remind all of us that it is today Gita Jayanti. Yes. So that is a very special day for us people here in India, because it is the day when the traditions believe that Arjuna heard the Bhagavad Gita from Krishna on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, when the mystical teachings of the Bhagavad Gita, and that is why all ashrams in Rishikesh would have been reciting the Bhagavad Gita, all the 700 verses, which takes around 1.5 hours early in the morning.
Would have been?
Yeah, have been. Yeah. Supposedly, I've not seen it.
So, yeah, exactly.
So, but I heard it, of course, on the. Yeah. Oh, Shivananda Ashram certainly, Kailas Ashram, most of the ashrams certainly do it. So, we'll be studying the Upanishads. We are not studying the Bhagavad Gita, but in the Upanishads lies the very source of the Bhagavad Gita. There is this famous saying that Sarva Upanishadaha Gavaha, the cows that we see with Lord Krishna, these cows represent, in fact, the teachings of the Upanishads. And this is a little bit complicated to explain, because it is rooted in the Sanskrit word for cow, which is gau, which is very similar also to the English word cow. But the word gau, the word go in Sanskrit, means so many different things. It means Mother Earth, it means the cow, and it also means a ray of light. That is what the Sanskrit word gau means. And therefore, in fact, when we go back to the most ancient collection of teachings where symbolical language is extremely prominent, cows as animals are in fact seen as representative, seen as symbolizing the rays of light, in other words, the rays of wisdom, the rays of knowledge. Because the word go also means cow, and the word go also means rays of light. So therefore, cow represents, symbolizes the rays of wisdom, the rays of knowledge. So the cows that we see, whose one of the famous names of Krishna is Gopala, the cow herd, you know, and symbolically, when the masters explain it, then the cows of which he is a cow herd, they represent the rays of wisdom, the rays of Vedic wisdom. And so therefore this mantra beautifully points, this shloka, this verse beautifully points it out, that sarva upanishado gavaha, all the Upanishads are the cows, the rays of wisdom, the rays of knowledge. Dugdha Gopala Nandanaha, and the son of the cowherd, which means Krishna, he is the one who takes out the milk. The milk is the essence. The milk is the essence of the cow. So what he takes out is the milk. Partho Vatsaha, his student Arjuna, is like a calf which needs to be there so that the milk comes out. I always see it whenever I go to take milk in the goshala. Then I see that first the cow has to suck a little bit, and then the milk comes down, then it is taken away, and then milk is taken out. So the calf has to be there. Partho Vatsaha, Arjuna is that calf. Sudhir Bhokta, and the wise people are the ones that enjoy the milk. All. Partho Vatsaha, Sudhir Bhokta, Dugdham Gita Amritam Mahat, and the milk is the Bhagavad Gita. The Upanishads are extremely detailed. It takes years and years together. Even I think when Swami Vishnu Devananji, who was the sixth master of Kailas Ashram, this extremely traditional ashram of Rishikesh, which is one of the best places in North India to study Advaita Vedanta, and has taught students including great world masters like Swami Vivekananda. So the sixth master in that tradition, Swami Vishnu Devananda, who in my opinion, it is my humble opinion, but was the greatest scholar in the whole tradition within the last 150 years. And this means a lot because this tradition has created great scholars who have served all the different parts of India and also parts of the world. And he, when he was asked, how long did it take you to study the Upanishads? He said, 12 years. And this doesn't mean this. Sometimes, you know, after studying, he said the first nine Upanishads, and this is just for the 10 principal Upanishads. He said the first eight Upanishads take 6 years. Again, I'm confused. It's an old. The first nine Upanishads take 6 years, and the last, the 10th one, the biggest one, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, takes another 6 years. So, it is quite detailed. The Upanishads are extremely detailed. What Srimad Bhagavad Gita does, that within 700 verses really takes the essence. And the beautiful thing about the essence is that the essence is always the same. And this is again one thing that the Upanishads themselves point out, that you see, teachings can be different, books can be different, teachings differ from book to book. But if you grasp the quintessential aspect of it, which is like the milk, then it is universal. It is always white. In other words, the milk is always white. The cow can be black, it can be white, it can be red, it can be of so many different colors. But the milk will always be white. So ultimately, what someone needs to do with the Upanishads, and I would say with all teachings of the masters, is to grasp the essence, which is always the same. And that is what ultimately nourishes us. Shri Krishna's attempt in the Bhagavad Gita is to present the quintessence of the Upanishads according to his own experience and understanding. And that is why it becomes Yoga Shastra. If Patanjali's work is called the Yoga Sutras, the aphorisms of yoga, Srimad Bhagavad Gita is called Yoga Shastra, the text, the teachings, the scriptures on yoga. And I think it is this quintessential nature of the Bhagavad Gita which, like the Upanishads, is most likely, as far as I can think of right now, is the only text from the post-Upanishadic periods which was universally accepted by all traditions, all diverse traditions of Hinduism. And this is a big thing, because Hindu traditions differ from each other considerably. They can, just two traditions sometimes can really be completely opposite to each other. And when it comes to the Vedas, when it comes to the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita, they respect, even though it is found in a Vaishnavite context, and yet it is universally accepted by Shaivas, by Shaktas, by all the different traditions and sub-traditions. That is the beautiful thing of it, because it goes really into the essence and doesn't worry too much about the superficial differences, the superficial things. And that is what makes it really, like yoga in general, a universal teaching, a universal collection of teaching. I think the most beautiful part of the Bhagavad Gita, of course, everybody is free to choose their own beautiful part of the Bhagavad Gita. The one that I like most is this small little statement that Shri Krishna repeats twice. And there are very few statements in the Bhagavad Gita in which Shri Krishna literally repeats himself, but this is one of them. It comes twice, first in the 5th chapter and then in the 12th chapter. Sarva bhuta hiderata. I see this really as the quintessential teaching of the Bhagavad Gita. It inspires the listener to be constantly engaged in the well-being of all beings. That is what I see really the essence of the Bhagavad Gita. More than this, we will discuss when we will study the Bhagavad Gita as an intensive course in January. So if you are here, it will be lovely to have you with us. But such questions, why it had to be spoken in a battlefield, and how does this influence our understanding? Is it a violent book? Or does it propagate violence in any way or the other? All such questions will be discussed then. Coming back now to the discussion that we were having in our last session, this was just important because today is Gita Jayanti, so...
But Jains are not accepting.
No. Jains and Buddhists not. So that is why I just said that within all the traditions within Hinduism. But I think that are you sure about that?
Yes, they didn't allow us to
Ah, okay. Okay. I remember visiting the Jain temples in Hastinapur and the beautiful recitation of the Jain nuns. Yeah, they would feel a little bit no.
Except if we leave the Bhagavad Gita outside.
Okay. That is quite strange because unlike Buddhism, which has some negative things to say about Krishna, Jainism has actually developed a very beautiful mythology around Krishna. And according to Jain mythology, Krishna is the future master. Mahavira, whom they worship, is the previous one, and the future one is actually Krishna. And there are beautiful stories around which are quite similar to the Hindu stories but slightly different, and they present Krishna in a picture that I must say is more respectful than sometimes even the Hindu traditions. Because in Hindu traditions sometimes you find Krishna, you know, lying or taking, opportunistic, you know, or making others to lie for a good purpose, but he does it. He does it, you know. So he's that that problematic personality which throws away the conventions at times, you know. That is the beautiful aspect in Hinduism about Krishna. But Jainism gets rid of this aspect of Krishna. In Jainism, Krishna is just a perfect master who is righteous in every possible way. You know, that is their conception of Krishna.
Like
so
Ram.
I'm quite sorry.
Ram.
Like Ram in Hinduism, who is just perfect in every.
What did the Buddhists say about Krishna?
I don't exactly now remember, but there is one story.
Which Buddhists?
I think it's in the. It was a long time ago when I went into this comparative thing, and of course the general accusation that Buddhists make is on the Hindus is that all your gods are violent. Extremely violent. Violent. They are violent. You know. That is the general accusation that comes up again, and they kill a lot, and that sort of it is that that accusation that which they accuse. And but exactly there are some stories there, but at the moment I'm completely not clear about it, so I will not talk about it.
I read once someplace, I can't remember who said it, but that Buddhism is Hinduism without all of the gods. Like just the essence of Hinduism, you know.
That is, in a way, I mean,
it's kind of true.
The point is that the Buddha is a tree which was produced on a fertile ground, which was made fertile by the teachings of the Upanishads. Because Upanishads really prepare the foundation for someone like Buddha to arise. So, and Buddha was not a political person, he was not even a religious person, but I would say he was a deeply spiritual, a deeply mystical person who emphasized so much on direct experience and the straight path. That is the beauty of his teachings. And when it comes to his teachings, all the Buddhist masters' teachings on meditation, there is nothing parallel to that anywhere else. That is a very clear statement. I'm very clear about it. But whether Buddhism is Hinduism without all the gods, then they have their own gods and goddesses, and they have their own rituals, and I mean,
but they created them after.
Yeah, they created them after. Yes, yes.
But not all Buddhism, I think.
Yeah, Theravada is not. Theravada, Zen Buddhism is not. Yes, but most of the Mahayana, particularly, they have their different forms, and even Theravada has Avalokiteshvara and the different form of the Buddha. So that's quite a general statement. But yeah. Okay. So what we find in the Buddha's teachings is deep respect to the ancient masters of the Vedas and a rebuke of the Brahmins of his time who were running after wealth and fame and trying to please the kings. So that is where he told them, look at your ancestors, Brahmanidhima Paliyum, whose life was dedicated to preserve, nourish and promote this treasure of Brahman, this treasure of wisdom, by living in solitude, by living a life of renunciation. And look at yourself, what you are doing, the custodian of these teachings. That is what he said, and that is where he becomes extremely meaningful, and he really sort of revived the deeper mystical interest which we find in the Upanishads, but which was lacking in the Brahmins at his times, who were more just like an institutionalized priesthood, you know. So that is extremely beautiful. So he criticizes, but he criticizes in a very valid light, which is extremely meaningful. In any case, coming back to the discussion that we were having, we were discussing this first part of the mantra, Shanno Mitraha. May Mitra bring peace and happiness to us. And we were discussing the significance of Mitra. Mitra, by the way, I just realized after the class that last time when we were discussing Mitra, it was Mitra Saptami. It was the day when Mitra is supposed to be worshipped once a year. That is the day of Mitra. So last time when we studied about Mitra, it was Mitra Saptami. And I didn't know, I just came to know later. That's why I didn't mention it. And these forms of light are also important and meaningful when we understand them, because Surya Namaskara is deeply related to that. Like the ancient Vedic traditions in which a person bows down, which means submits this tiny little individual ego in front of the light as a symbol to the supreme light of consciousness, what is done in Surya Namaskara is inspired by that, and that is why 12 names of the light have been enumerated. Each posture is related to one of the mantras. And the first mantra there is Om Mitraya Namaha, the first one, which is dedicated to Mitra. So the discussion that we were having was also meaningful in that context. The first three forms, Mitra, Varuna and Aryaman, these three, I will discuss each one of them in greater detail. Mitra I have already done. Varuna and Aryaman I need to do. Each one of them is a form of light, and how to differentiate between them is quite a difficult task, because you cannot differentiate between light. But it's just a different aspect of light. Mitra is the light of the day. The light of the day. Varuna is the absent light at night, yet the sun is there. It is present. It has complete influence on us. But if you ask someone, if you try to say this to someone, they would say, no, but I cannot see it. It has gone. Well, it has not gone. It is there. But you just cannot see it. So that hidden aspect of light, simply because the earth has turned away from it, therefore, even though it is there, its presence is not felt, that aspect of light, that is Varuna. And Aryaman is specifically the solar disk up there. When we speak of light, the sun's light is also here. It is also here. It is everywhere. It is omnipresent. It is everywhere. But when we speak of the solar disk, then it is up there. So that one is only the third one, Aryaman. So my point of stating this in the beginning is that let us not confuse Mitra with the sun, which is up there. three aspects of Mitra which we discussed in our last session are most important for a practitioner of yoga. First of all, this tendency that the moment Mitra comes into being, which means Varuna subsides, the light of the night transforms into Mitra, into daylight, it stirs everyone into action. So that aspect of the light, that it has the capacity to stir, to make us active. We were completely asleep in darkness. Darkness, the darkness of ignorance, makes us inactive, inert. But the light wakes us up. So that tendency of waking us up and stirring us into action, that is what infatuated the Vedic masters. This aspect of Mitra they really loved and spoke about so much. The second one, of course, that it is the deity of the day. And the third one was also because the deity who brought peace between conflicting parties by being a witness to their proclamation that from now onwards I will have no evil intentions towards you. So for this they took that light of the day as the witness, because it was also seen as the universal eye that sees everything, whatever happens during the day, because whatever happens during the day happens in sun's light. So in that sense, because sun's light is present everywhere during the day, Mitra is present everywhere, it knows everything, whatever is done. And therefore it can be invoked as that universal witness. And it is in that sense that we also saw that the Mitannis in Syria had already invoked him, and there are archaeological evidence that they had invoked him in their treaties with the Hittites 1500 BC. So already these Vedic ideas had traveled from India in 1500 BC back then. And this is not only an Indo-European, because of the very language and the very names of the kings and emperors that the Mitannis had, they had Sanskrit names. So it was not just an Indo-European tradition, but it was specifically very clearly related to the ancient Vedic traditions. That is how it seems to me from what I have studied, because it's directly related to Sanskrit language, the Vedic Sanskrit, specifically the Vedic Sanskrit. Not even what they call the Indo-Iranian, not even that. That is ancient. But this doesn't come from Iran. It comes straight from India. You can only relate it back to India. You cannot relate it to Iran. Like Mithraism, for example, in Europe, comes from Iran. So you cannot relate it directly to India. But that Syrian Mitanni kingdom cannot be related to Iran. It has to be related to the Vedic, to the civilization which developed in the Indo-Gangetic Valley. That is how I understand it. So, Shannu Mitraha. When we have these discussions, it is always important to remind us something that Sureshwaracharya reminds us of in the very beginning. And Sureshwaracharya is one of the four or five greatest original thinkers in the Advaita Vedanta tradition. And I consider them original thinkers because they many times contradict or even stand up against what the previous masters have established or accepted. In that sense, they are original thinkers. And Sureshwaracharya is one of them. What he says that when we look at this Shanno Mitraha, Shamvarunaha, these various names of the divinities, it's not that we are requesting or asking the individual deity But it is what he calls the connecting principle, what he calls sutratman, the connecting thread, the consciousness which is present within each one of them. It is that to which the prayer ultimately is directed. It is not directed to an individual manifestation, but the entity, the one single entity which is present within each one of them. And this becomes clear from the later part of the mantra, Namo Brahmane Namaste Vayu. Because that word Vayu, Prana, is that connecting principle, that when he bows down to Vayu, to Prana, which the Upanishads declare to be the Sutratman, the self that like a thread connects all entities, all manifestations together. So ultimately, this prayer is directed to that entity. It's not directed to a certain physical or limited manifestation. And that is why when we have such discussions, it is important to keep in mind that it's not what in the West we have come to know as a polytheistic tradition. And these are maybe unnecessary discussions for us, but it is necessary for the sake of clarity, because polytheism in that sense does simply not exist, at least not in the Advaita Vedantic and Vedic understanding, where from the very beginning, from the most ancient collection of teachings, it is already clearly stated. There also Mitra has been stated, Indram, Mitram, Varunam, Agnim Ahuratho Divyasya Suparno Garutman. Some call it Mitra, some call it Indra, some call it Varuna. Ekam Sat. But the existence is one. But, and this is what everybody accepts, pure existence is one. But in what the Vedic teachings I see are unique is that they accept that one truth, the moment it is expressed in words and in concepts, it can be expressed in numerous ways. Why should it only be expressed in one particular way, or in one particular form, or in one particular philosophical concept? Why? Why? There is no answer to that. It's not necessary, because words, philosophical concepts, are nothing but windows into the infinite truth. And each window will be overlapping and will be showing a different aspect of the infinite truth. It has to be seen in that way. So that lies at the very foundation of the Vedic teachings, which the Advaita Vedantic traditions have developed further. So even if apparently it seems like a polytheistic tradition, deep down the foundation is completely monotheistic in nature, if we can use these terms. And I suspect that many polytheistic traditions of the ancient world, which were just discarded apparently as being polytheistic because of these external forms and their acceptance of diversity, were deep down at the core, they too were monotheistic in their approach. This is what I suspect, based on what I see in the Vedic traditions. And therefore, what we find in the Vedic traditions is that, for example, this statement that however one meditates on it, however one worships it, it becomes that. It assumes the form of that and gives protection and nourishment to the worshipper in that particular form. And therefore, this is from the Yajurveda, one who knows this essential truth, that it is the one same entity which manifests itself in all these forms, there is nothing to hinder him from meditating and worshipping upon it in all these different forms. It becomes all these forms and it protects and nourishes by becoming all these forms. So this acceptance of various forms lies at the very foundation. So in this way, I think this is really the all-embracing nature and the all-inclusive nature of the Vedic teachings, which Advaita Vedanta tradition really develops to the greatest extent further. And it is with that in our mind that we need to look. So in other words, it embraces both. It embraces polytheism as well as monotheism, but considering monotheism as the foundation and polytheism as a mention that arises above it due to the differences of human conception of the same truth. So in this way it embraces not only polytheism and not only monotheism, but what we understand even in the West as atheism. That is the most beautiful thing. You would be amazed that some of the ancient Vedic traditions, the Vaisheshikas, the atomists, the Sankhyas, who are the forerunners of the yoga tradition, and the Mimamsakas, the hardcore ritualist traditions, all the three reject the need of a creator God in their philosophical position. And so they are, from that definition, they are completely atheistic in nature. Even the Buddha, Buddha rejects the idea of God. And because it seems very much to have been in the milieu back then, the Sankhyas were atheists, the Mimamsakas were atheists, already in his time. And these were the prominent traditions. So he also, and they belong to the same, approximately to the same era, that there was no need for a creator, God. So in this way, it beautifully embraces the different, and accepts at least the different aspects of human conception of reality. A few years ago, I was giving a talk on this in one of the what they are called, you know, what they used to have on the other side, you know, when also you used to go and teach yoga, yoga festivals. Ah. Yeah, one of the yoga festivals. I was.
One of those things.
One of the yoga festivals. I talked about this Ekam Sat, that the truth is one. Then someone came up and said was this declaration in your scriptures, was it made before Ibrahim or Abraham or after that? Because I rather not go into that discussion, because it's just. But these are the type of questions that I sometimes, you know, get. But in any case, when we speak of the time period, some of these Vedic mantras go back at least to 2000 BC. So we are speaking about an extremely ancient period. Extremely ancient period. I have no interest in showing with others. Anyway, talking about what you said, you know, this idea of soul and God. Many people, particularly modern Vedantic masters, seem to make it, and I'm talking about really some very highly respected Vedantic masters from India today. It seems, when you look at their teachings, it seems that everything in Vedanta is about understanding what the soul is and what God is. So it's all about that. And this is, I think, the truth cannot be further than from such a statement. Because, though it is extremely complex to explain, but what Vedanta would say is that Vedanta has this idea of let me try to explain it the way the Vedantic masters explain it, that there are four types of spaces. You know, four types of spaces. You have a space in a pot, the space within a pot, and you have the infinite space out there. These two spaces are very clear. Though the division is just created by the limitation of the pot, which is a created entity, which is created within space itself. It does not really limit space because space is too subtle. It is the very essence of each and every atom of that It is the very essence of that limitation. That limitation ultimately arises within space, yet to our conception, to our understanding, it seems to limit space and create a division. So you have these two spaces, a jar, we can call it a jar space, and the infinite space. Now, Vedanta adds two more spaces to this, to make us understand what soul and God, about which everybody worries, but about which Vedanta worries the least and actually tells us not to worry about these two entities. And this, I'm not making up these things. Vidyaranya Muni, this 13th century master of Vedanta, one of the four or five original thinkers of Vedanta, comes up with this idea. I'm just using his explanation and his metaphor. So what he says, now add two more spaces to it. Put a little bit of water into your jar, and then the space above is reflecting in that water. You get the point? Yes. You have water in there, and the space up there, the infinite space, is reflecting in that pot, in that water within the pot. So now you have two spaces in the pot. One is the space which was already present there, which also gives room to the water, in which the infinite space once again gets reflected. And then he says, like there is a little bit of water in this pot, there is a lot of water up there in the clouds. So just have faith that some kind of reflection of the space must be taking place in that water also. You know? So that reflection, so now you have two spaces out there, the original infinite space, and then its reflection in the water, the great amount of water. And it is there, nobody can deny it, because it falls down. And then all the rivers, all the water that we see on the planet Earth, except of course the oceans, but whatever is there, it's part of that circle, and it travels up there. So now just think that the infinite space would also be casting a huge reflection in that water. So then you have two spaces up there. One is the infinite original space and its reflection in the clouds, in the water of the clouds. Vidyaranya Muni, he says, the soul that you worry about is the reflection of that space in the water that is within the jar. And the God that you worry about is the reflection of that infinite space in that water which is in the clouds. Forget about varying these two things and think about that, meditate on that, of which these two are the reflections, which is one and the same. That is how he puts it. Tasman mumukshubhir naiva madir jiveshavadayoh. That's why those who seek the path of freedom should not worry too much and should not get engrossed in the discussions of about God, Isha, about God and Jiva, about a soul, but karya kintu brahma tattvam vicharyam, but they should contemplate the essential substance of which both are the reflection, buddhyatam chatat, and not only understand it but experience it. Because even if I identify myself just with this limited space, within this limited space, if I experience rather than that reflection but the space itself which supports the water and the reflection both, if I meditate on that, then there is a possibility of experiencing that, and that tiny limited space within myself is one and the same with this infinite space, because the division that is there is meaningless. So this is how Vedanta approaches that question. When I come across such things, sometimes I myself forget these things, but then again something reminds me of these teachings, then I often get reminded of what my master used to say, that you see, he used to use the word, and not only he, many ancient masters have used this word, Vedanta Kesari. Vedanta Kesari, which means the lion of Vedanta. And what it means is that when the lion of Vedanta roars, then other animals which are having petty quibbles about their own tiny little issues, you know, they stop quibbling with each other under the roar of Vedanta. That is how some of the masters have presented it. And it is a play on Sanskrit word, because you know the most noisy are the birds. And the Sanskrit word for birds is pakshi. Also in Hindi language it is pakshi. And pakshi means those with wings, but pakshi also means those who belong to a wing, which means right wing, left wing, you know, that which belong to a particular party, partisans. That is what pakshi in Sanskrit, it can mean both. It can mean birds and it can mean those who belong to a particular group. So my master, Swami Ramananji Maharaj, a great Vedantin of the 20th century, he used to say that all the noise is made always by the pakshis, by the birds. They are the noisy ones, you know. Whenever they come together on a tree, they are just making so much noise. But then, when once the lion of Vedanta roars, then all of them, they forget what they were traveling, what they were quarreling about. So, I think it is the statement. And many times, when people find a problem with statements like Tattvamasi, you are that, Aham Brahmasmi, I am that pure consciousness, it is because we don't understand the deeper aspect of Vedanta, the beautiful aspect of Vedanta. Most of the, criticism of Vedanta which comes, you know, on such statements is because we don't understand what Vedanta really means when it uses the word I, when it uses the word you, when it uses these words. It does not use it in a conventional sense, but it uses it in a different meaning. So, yeah, Shanno Mitra. I think it was important because when we are going through these various names so that they don't lead us to some misunderstanding, it is important to go back to the very foundations, to the aim that is being aimed at by such prayers, you know, may Mitra give happiness to us. Now we are becoming deep down, despite being aware of our true essence in our daily life, it is one of the most important things to be humble, to bow down in front of that which is something greater, which can help us to lift ourselves up from this darkness of ignorance, to give up our limited ego so that a window will open in which that wisdom can enter. And it is for this purpose that such statements, Shanno Mitraha Shamvarunaha, come. So, I think just let me take some questions and continue this discussion next time. Yes. Yes. Yeah. The way I look at the idea of Shunya and Brahman, because Shunya is really the quintessence of Buddhism, Brahman is the quintessence of the Upanishads, and when you start from down, you have Buddhism on one side of the mountain and you have Vedanta on the other side of the mountain, because what Buddhism seems to have is an emphasis on negativity, on negation, on asat, on the absence, and what Vedanta's propensity is more towards sat, towards describing it as presence. But when you go, when you really reach the pinnacle of both, then the definition of Shunya, as presented by the Madhyam, by the great Madhyamaka master Nagarjuna, as the denial of four categories: existence, non-existence, both, and the absence of both. These four categories. It is exactly the same in Vedanta, that Brahman is the denial, is in fact, it cannot be described as sat, it cannot be described as asat. It is what we call in Sanskrit chatushkoti vinirmukta, free from all the four categories. You cannot categorize it as one out of these four. It's everything. That's it.
As soon as you do, then you have its opposite.
Then you have its opposite. And this is an all-encompassing entity. So in that sense, Brahman and Shunya are completely the same. I don't see why there should be a difference. Even linguistically, grammatically, the word shunya, which is derived from the root shvi, and the word Brahman, which is derived from the root brahma, both roots have the same meaning: to increase. So it's simply Brahman and shunya both mean the most increased entity, the biggest, you can call it the mightiest, the greatest, whatever you want to call it. So, very grammatically speaking. Yes?
Two thoughts I have. One, as you were talking about space, this interesting article I was reading just a while back about the gravitational waves, which I find extremely fascinating that they discovered these waves, which are two black holes that came together. And something that I read about the black hole is that it's larger inside than outside.
Wow.
And that is an amazing thought.
That's an amazing thought.
I had to meditate on that for a while, that it's larger inside than outside. You know, even to say it seems like a contradiction.
Like a contradiction.
That's what they have discovered, which is absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
And I think it teaches a lot also about our mind.
By our mind, yes, about ourselves.
You were talking, it's interesting you were saying about God, you know, Buddha and Sankhya, they were, you know, atheistic, if that word did not exist at the time, but anyway,
yeah.
You know, this idea of God, and then how people have this idea of maybe Hinduism being about many gods. But the idea of God is a created form anyways by the mind.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to see how just one God is never enough for the individual. right? I mean, once you create that God, then it becomes fragmented into different types of gods. Then everybody goes back to saying, okay, it's all just one God. Fine, in a word, people say that.
But
in reality, in their real lives, in their minds, depending on where they were born, their culture, tradition, their religion, it becomes all of these little fragmented little objects of all these little different gods. And
yes.
You create.
Yes.
You know,
I think that
you create your own individual God, like
yeah.
This person who asked you if Abraham had said that. It's the own individual God thought.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So all of these little bits, it's never enough.
Yeah. It's
for
never
a person
enough.
Until
yes.
Actually, as Buddha did, just said, clean slate, get rid of all of
get
that.
Get rid of all of that.
You know,
yes.
Because
yes.
Otherwise you will continue to create
yeah.
Your own little bitty God, and that
yeah.
God. Big or little, whatever, becomes in like an object, actually.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
There are moments in one's life, and I think that the answer to this lies in the word God itself. When I looked up this word God in the Oxford University, Oxford Dictionary, it is rooted in a very ancient Indo-European word, which is also used in the Vedas, Huta. Huta, which from ha becomes ga and ta becomes da. So it is directly, in fact, directly related. The word God is directly related to Huta. And Huta means called upon.
Huh?
Called upon. So call upon. When you
call upon.
To call upon someone. Yeah. That which is called upon. That is what the word Huta in Sanskrit means.
There.
Yes,
immediate
and Indra, for example, one of these, the wielder of the thunderbolt, which will explain what it means. He is referred to as Puruhuta, the one being called upon by many. So the word Huta is used there, and that is most likely, according to the Oxford Dictionary, it is the Sanskrit, it is the Indo-European root of the English word God. And there are moments in life when you feel so powerless, when you feel so, because of the situation around you, whatever the reason is. And in that moment, as an individual, I myself have experienced it in those dark, painful moments. You need something to which you can cling, you can hold to. And it gives, you know what will happen. But still just this capacity to cling to something that is greater than yourself. And the faith that you have that ultimately, whatever the outcome will be, it will be fine. It will be okay. And I will be strong enough to accept it. Just let me go through it. In those moments, I find that, at least personally, just speaking personally, it doesn't mean that anybody else has to relate with it, but personally I find it a source of great inner strength. And that is what that aspect, you know, that you can just let go for those moments and just say, okay, now, it's your worries. It's for you. It's for the universe to worry. It's for you to take care of my situation. I cannot do anything about it now.
I have a personal question to ask you about this. Do you do the same thing when you're feeling great moments of happiness and joy? Is that same essence there?
I'll have to think about it. It's there that yes. And to this, I think one master he would say that everybody calls upon God in the moments of pain and suffering. If we would start to call upon Him in the moments of joy and happiness. Then there will be no reason for suffering at all. Yes, yes, yes. The moments of joy and happiness are for me when I think about these Vedantic thoughts of oneness and but universal
is that essence,
identification.
Is that God in there when you're thinking about them? Okay.
Any other observations on this? On this, or different from this? Yes.
During the example of the pot, the water, unity, and the clouds are not the gods of Hinduism?
We are not talking about clouds being reflected, but it's about the space being reflected in the water. The water stands for the intellect, for the mind. The reflection in it of the infinite space, but the tiny little reflection in it, that is comparable to the embodied consciousness, the embodied soul. But you were saying something about the clouds.
Yes, the water of the pot, something that is in between the world and in between the pot, and I was wondering if that thing could be assimilate to the gods of Hinduism, half entity, like half god or something like that.
That I would have to think about it, but the different deities, the different devatas, are simply manifestations of different energies operating in this universe and making our existence possible. So the 33 deities, I don't even like the word gods because it has a very strong cultural connotation, but yeah, how we use it, devata, which simply means a luminary, that's all what it means, a manifestation of energy. So if you look at the list of these 33 deities, the first, they are grouped together. The first eight, for example, include earth, the sun, fire, the different elements, and like this. Just let me finish this. And then the second group is the 11 luminaries, which are the five senses of action, five senses of perception, and the 11th mind. So they are active within our body. And then the group of 12 new luminaries is the sun in its 12 forms, in the 12 months. So like this you have, and they make, that is related to time. Because the circle of time, these 12 forms related to. So they are powers at work in space and time which make our existence possible. But at the core of these 33 lies the one prana, which is the ultimate life force of which each one of them is seen as simply a manifestation. Yes. I talked about
polytheism.
Polytheism, yes.
And it's sort of subsiding in monotheism and vice versa. And
yes,
it's kind of being a reflection of how God is within,
yes,
and above.
Yes.
Each one of us is like our own God, and this is a reflection of universal consciousness. But how do you elevate consciousness then if it's always kind of just a reflection? Is there a specific set of criteria of consciousness or something that we're moving towards, or is it just a recognition of it all being united?
I think what Vedanta would say, that it is a recognition. It is just a recognition. And the very specific word in this context, which has been used in, because the Sanskrit word for recognition is pratyabhijja, which has become the central idea of Kashmir Shaivism, the non-dualistic tradition of Kashmir Shaiva Siddhanta, the recognition school. In any case, what Vedanta would say is that it is just a recognition. And development towards that simply means, because the crystal is transparently clean even when it is placed on a black blue or red surface. It seemingly is black, blue or red. It only seemingly becomes. Now for us to actually experience it as it is, one would have to lift it away from the surface and show that, you see, look at this. This is completely clean and transparent. And it's not only clean and transparent now, but it was also when it was placed on a black surface. And it will be the same when you place it on a black surface. But just what is required is the awareness of that it is like this. The capacity to see it the way it is. That is what they would call yathabhutartha darshana, to see things as they really are. So it's just a recognition. It is not something that is why it is also referred to sometimes as a pathless path. You know, anadvaga advasuparaishnavaha, those who want to reach the other side of this path never actually walk on a path. This is how it is expressed. Because, yeah, otherwise what it seems like, you know, we are walking towards something, working towards something. We are just working towards creating that awareness. That's all. Which we already were, are, and will be. In the understanding of Vedanta. So it does not create a new world order. But the world is already perfect. But it just makes us aware.
I was reading something, I think. There was a Buddhist, an ancient Buddhist, Zen Buddhist teacher who was saying something about describing consciousness before. It's this beautiful, magnificent thing that you kind of think about, this ox consciousness. But when actually the people who have become aware of it, it's just like, oh, well, that's it. It becomes less magnificent, yeah. Because it just is.
It just is. It's beautiful. Yeah. It's indeed. No. Very, very beautiful.
Just, oh, that's
yes,
it.
That's
okay.
It.
Okay.
Move ahead. Let's move ahead.
It's more of this.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's new age stuff.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Simplicity. Extreme simplicity. Yes. Extreme simplicity. That's what the master is trying to point at. Yes. 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 But that doesn't sell.
It doesn't sell. People want to die.
So they have to see the worth of something. And that's why there are so strong prohibitions against selling, particularly the Vedic wisdom. So strong prohibitions when it comes to the Upanishadic teachings and to the Vedic teachings in any way. Okay, any?
Sorry.
Yes, please.
Is Varuna also the deity of moonlight then? Or does that have a different...
No. Chandrama is completely different. We will discuss Varuna in our next session. It is still the sun, but the sun at night. Of course, what the Vedic masters knew very well is that the moon has no light of its own. It's just reflecting the sun's light. And they had also a very specific word for the ray of the sun, which enlightens the moon and makes it seemingly enlightened. They called that Sushumna, which later on was taken by the yogis as the Sushumna Nadi. But this is an extremely ancient word, and it is used for the sun's ray, which enlightens the moon at night. That particular light of the sun, which enlightens the moon, they call it Sushumna. I think it is masculine there, and in the yogic context, because it becomes an adjective of the nadi, of a channel of energy, it becomes Sushumna, it becomes feminine.
You cannot see the sun's rays.
No, you cannot see it. You cannot see it. Yes, you cannot see it. Yes, yes, unless they are reflected. Yes. And this is also metaphorically deeply related, because consciousness, pure consciousness, is like the sun, and moon is the mind.
Yeah.
the intellect, the ego, the reservoir of all our memories, that is like the moon, and it is with the light of the sun that it is enlightened. And what happens in the deepest states of meditation is that the moon is no more enlightened anymore by the light of the sun, even though the sun is there, and the moon is also there, but you don't see the moon anyway. That is what they would call laya yoga, when the mind has become completely non-existent, unmani avastha, the transcendental state, which is the deepest state of meditation, asamprajnata samadhi. That is why full moon is related to all the earlier stages of meditation, but new moon is deeply symbolical of the deepest state of meditation. Yeah. That is why Amavasya, new moon, you know, which is, for example, Mauni Amavasya, there are so many Amavasyas. Most of the rituals in India, they are on full moon. They are performed on full moon. And new moons are periods of complete silence. You know, complete silence. Mauni Amavasya, complete mauna.
The female body works on the moon, the lunar system, which is very interesting.
Yeah, which is very interesting. Yes.
Forget every day there's a full lunar.
Yeah, full lunar. Yes. Yes. Today in India we follow the solar calendar, but traditionally India has always followed the lunar calendar. And Nepal, I think, is the only country. That is why when you talk to a Nepali person, even for me, you know, they completely follow our original, which was our original lunar calendar, but it becomes difficult. Okay, tell me the date.
Yeah.
That is how even I react to such a Nepali person, because they follow the original lunar calendar, which has an additional 13 month every 12 years and becomes extremely complicated sometimes. And that is why Deepavali and all our celebrations shift nearly by 1 month every 2 years.
And the Christian calendar, it's Easter?
Yeah.
It's decided upon by the moon.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Still, if you have any questions, I'm here, so don't worry. But let us conclude. Sukhinaha, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kaschid dukha bhag bhavet. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi.